language pathologist with over 10 years of experience, an expert in assessment, diagnosis, and treatment of communication disorders, especially in children. Trained in management of speech and hearing disorders, she excels in providing comprehensive treatment solutions for speech, language fluency, social, cognitive communication, and swallowing disorders. Her fields of special interest include management of pediatric speech-language disorders and autism spectrum disorders. Head of the Pediatric Speech-Language Pathology Division at Aster KIND, Kochi. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Maria Grace, who will share with us her research on procedural memory in children with autism, double dissociation.
Good evening, everybody. I'm really excited and inspired by listening to all the wonderful speakers. So let us give a big applause to Dr. Vijay Raghavan sir and the CADRRE team. Let's join a signer. I think this is a sign. Can I see hands go up? This is a sign for clap. So thank you very much, sir, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be a part of this team. Well, I would like to share with you it's a simple study on a small sample. It's on procedural memory in children with autism, double dissociation. I would be going through what's memory and then what's language and how memory and language is related and how is memory in various language disorders. And then I would come down to the procedural memory in autism. Well, this is a well-known model by Atkinson and Schifrin. It's a multi-store model of memory. If you're listening to what I'm saying, that is, if you're paying attention to what I'm saying, so the information goes into your short-term memory. And if you rehearse, once you get back and rehearse what you're listening, it goes into your long-term memory. So long-term memory has two components. That is, you have procedural memory and the declarative memory, okay? The DP model by Allman, it states that these two systems have been co-opted for language. Learning occurs and there's storage and then comes the usage of language. Well, I would quote Sir Mukund Muthukad sir's magic. So we'll again get back to that. So if I ask you it was a very memorable experience, I'm sure all of us would never forget this performance of Anil sir and how Muthukad sir was doing the magic. So if you see the process of learning the magic and executing it, it takes time. The process of learning takes time and it occurs over a period of time. But once it's learned, then it's used automatically. He is doing it very, very naturally. There's no conscious recollection of that. So that process of learning how to do magic is sustained by the procedural memory, and the process of listening and, the listeners who have been watching the magic, so you would remember how and where it was done, and who performed well, and what was done, and all those things are sustained by the declarative memory. So basically, procedural memory is governed by a system of rules for combining units based on a particular sequence, and it is used automatically. Whereas declarative memory is learned consciously, like those of you who have come for the first time to Kerala, so it'll be hard for you to, you have to learn consciously certain words of Malayalam, the foreign speakers, and then certain place names. So once it's learned consciously and it's available for conscious recollection, so there you use your declarative memory. So these are the hippocampus and the medial temporal lobe are the structures which underlie the declarative memory. And the frontal lobe and the basal ganglia circuits sustain the procedural memory. Then how is it related to language? We know the basic components of language is the grammar, that's the syntax, morphology, and phonology that deals with the structure of language. And then you have the content, that's the meaning of words and sentences. And then comes the usage of language, that's the pragmatics. So here's an example for you. This is colorless green ideas sleep furiously, given by Chomsky, who's the father of modern linguistics. Do you think it makes any sense? Do you think the sentence makes any sense? Colorless green ideas sleep furiously. No? Can I get the answers? Yes or no? No. Why do you think it is a nonsensical sentence? Yeah, because colorless cannot go with green, and ideas cannot sleep. And if you sleep, you can't sleep furiously. So that's perfect. I mean, it's very clear that although it's syntactically correct, there's a noun phrase, there's a verb phrase, it's perfect grammatical sentence, but then it doesn't make any sense. Okay? So how is this two components related to memory? So this grammar is syntax, and the meaning is semantics. So as I said, procedural memory involves rules, sequential rules of word combinations, and also the grammar aspect, the phonology, the morphology, syntax of language is sustained by procedural memory, whereas the semantics and some irregular morphological forms, like certain plurals, like which doesn't, for example, book and books. So that is a regular plural. That is sustained by the procedural memory, like words like feet and foot. So which is irregular, there is no S marker added. So irregular plural, they are stored in declarative memory. And what are the disorders wherein these memory systems are impaired? Procedural memory, as we all know, it's affected in specific language impairment, aphasia, autism, resulting in grammatical deficits. Whereas the declarative memory is affected in other language disorders like Alzheimer's, amnesia, resulting in naming or episodic memory deficits. So we all know that kids with autism have difficulty in sentence formulation, and but they have exceptional declarative memory. So they can learn words very fast. They have a huge vocabulary of words, but then they find it difficult to transition to the sentence level. So this has been attributed to procedural memory deficit as the underlying cause for the grammatical deficits. So they this causes difficulty in creating words with affixes on the basis of grammatical rules. So children with autism bypass the grammatical processing and store the word with suffixes as a whole unit using their spare declarative memory. Okay, for instance, table and tables, or so the S, or we'll take another example, like jumping, jumped. So it's a tense marker, ED is a past tense marker. So that whole word is stored, jumped is stored as a whole word in the declarative memory. They do not realize the rule of combining the past tense ED form to jump. So this was explained as seesaw effect in autism, because the intact declarative memory compensates for the procedural memory deficits. However, this does not work for non-words. True words, because true words with the suffixes are stored as a whole word in declarative memory, but since they are not exposed to any non-words in their previous learning experience, that is not stored in declarative memory. So that was the idea which, you know, led to the study. That is, using non-words, we can test the procedural memory because non-words are not stored in the declarative memory. So these authors, Bartoluk and Albers, they suggested the use of work test, which consists of non-words and inflecting the non-words. So due to a dearth of studies examining procedural memory across different modalities, the present study was planned. So is procedural memory impaired for both phonological orthographic domains in high-functioning children of autism? So as I told at the beginning, it's just a small sample of 10 kids with autism and 10 controls. They could complete a written task and verbal task of sentence completion. And they were recruited from Aster KIND and also my clinic, that's Carmel Speech Language Pathology Clinic. And some of them were attending occupational therapy. They had vocal limitation, good vocal limitation, and verbal repertoire of 4 to 5 word per sentences, and no auditory processing deficits. So in order to study the true word inflections, the test for examining expressive morphology was used. So it was used to investigate whether intact declarative memory compensates for procedural memory deficits in the clinical group. And the work test was used to examine the non-word inflections. So the picture stimuli of team and work test were presented along with the written or verbal sentence to elicit the target response. And each picture stimuli was presented with the target sentence, and the participants were instructed to inflect the target words verbally and through writing suffixes to true or non-words. So basically implementing a sentence completion task. And they received practice trials before starting the task to ensure that they understood the instructions. Scoring was 1 for correct and 0 for the incorrect. And this is a sample stimulus. You can see this is a work, and there are two of them. So there are two works. And the sample response. So in order to examine differences, independent sample t-test was conducted. So surprisingly, in the true word task, there was no significant difference between the clinical and the control groups in both the domains, both in orthographic and spoken domains, because they're high functional and they did perform well. So these are the results. You can see there's no significant difference between the means. So all those children with both the groups compared equally well, but the what is proposed is, what is hypothesized is that the reason why the clinical group performed well is because they would have utilized the intact declarative memory. Whereas the typical group has used the procedural memory because they can formulate a sentence based on grammatical rules and inflect the words correctly. And this also derives evidence from my previous study, which is unpublished, in Malayalam-speaking children with autism, wherein similar results were found. So the potential implication of the present study is that procedural memory training using intact orthographic modality. So what the results suggest is, to summarize, the clinical group performed, the clinical group had better orthographic procedural memory, that is better as compared to the phonological. That is, they performed poorly on the non-word verbal task. Okay, whereas they performed well on written procedural memory tasks. So that means to say that their orthographic procedural memory is good or better than the phonological one. So functional independence of phonological orthographic domains of procedural memory indicates double dissociation of procedural memory. Hence, these modalities may be affected in isolation as evident in children with autism. So double dissociation is hypothesized. So implication is procedural memory training could be used to using orthographic modality, could be used to enhance learning or learning of morphological rules in children with autism. Future studies on larger sample size and also longitudinal studies across the spectrum is recommended to investigate whether orthographic procedural memory training has an effect on phonological procedural memory or verbal expressive morphosyntax and establish clinical implications. These are the references. This is my team of doctors. This is Aster KIND, KIDS Integrated Neurodevelopmental Center. It's a part of the Department of Pediatrics, Aster Medicity Hospital. So altogether, there are 28 doctors in the Department of Pediatrics. So we have a small wing. It's in a growing stage. And we have a lot of kids with autism. So thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, Maria. Thank you. I request Harita, speech language pathologist at CADRRE, to present you your memento.